Please join me for the prayer of invocation. Let us pray. O Lord, our corrupt God and great, eternal, wonderful of glory, who keep us covenant and promise for those that love thee with their whole hearts, who art the life of all, the help of those that flee to thee, the hope of those that cry unto thee, cleanse us from our sins, and from every thought displeasing to thy goodness. Cleanse our souls and bodies, our hearts and consciences, that we cure our heart and clear mind, with perfect love and calm hope, we may confidently and fearlessly pray to thee, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
If any of you would like to come up for a children and youth message, you don't have to come up, but... Tough. Take that, Pilate, Caesar. Take that, Jews. You went and crucified Jesus. Well, look at the tomb. He's not there. Now, this guy, the Roman guards, Matthew tells us that they were like dead men. Chances are they did something in their uniforms that they probably had to go home and change afterwards. So, they were afraid. The angel didn't care about the Romans. But the ladies came up and he says, don't be afraid. I know you came looking for Jesus, but look at the tomb. He's not there. He is empty. The tomb is empty. Jesus has already gone on to Galilee, and that's where you're going to see him. And just like that, that was the first bit of evidence that Christ had given. Mary went and told the disciples. You know what? The disciples didn't even believe her at first until they saw. But that was the first Easter. And that is why we're here this morning. And just like that angel spread the good news and told the girls to spread the good news, that's what we're supposed to do. Let's pray. Holy Father, we thank you so much for the first Easter. We thank you for today. We thank you that you sent your Son so that we know what you are like, so that we know your love. We know how much you love us because you sent him to die for us. We pray this the only way that we can, in his name. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. spirit of prayer. Resurrecting God, you conquered death and opened the gates of life everlasting. In the power of the Holy Spirit, as we hear your word this morning, raise us with Christ and let the words live in us that we too may proclaim healing and peace to the nations. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from what is referred to as the Songs of the Suffering Servant. The songs are poems written about a certain servant of Yahweh. God calls the servant to lead the nations, but the servant is horribly abused among and finally killed. In the end, he is rewarded. I'm reading from Isaiah chapter 50, verses 4 to 9, and my favorite translation is the New Living Translation. I can understand it. The Sovereign Lord has given me his words of wisdom so that I know how to comfort the weary. Morning by morning, he wakens me and opens my understanding to his will. The Sovereign Lord has spoken to me, and I have listened. I've not rebelled or turned away. I offered my back to those who beat me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from mockery and spitting, because the Sovereign Lord helps me. I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a stone, determined to do his will. And I know that I will not be put to shame. He who gives me justice is near. Who will dare to bring charges against me now? Where are my accusers? Let them appear. See, the Sovereign Lord is on my side. Who will declare me guilty? All of my enemies will be destroyed, like old clothes that have been eaten like moths. Our gospel lesson this morning is the Apostle John's account of Mary Magdalene's encounter with the risen Christ early that first Easter morning. John chapter 20, verses 11 to 18. Mary was standing outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she stooped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. Dear woman, why are you crying? The angels asked her. Because they have taken away my Lord, she replied, and I don't know where they have put him. She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. Dear woman, why are you crying? Jesus asked her. Who are you looking for? She thought he was the gardener. Sir, she said, if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him. Mary, Jesus said. She turned to him and cried out, Rabboni, which is Hebrew for teacher. Don't cling to me, Jesus said, for I haven't yet ascended to the Father. But go, find my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told them, I have seen the Lord. Then she gave him his message. May God add his understanding and open our ears and our hearts so that we would understand his word.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jan, for that spirited reading, a spirited set of readings. Thank you, choir, for being here this Sunday and every Sunday. Thank you, Carol, for filling in. You'd never tell that she's not the regular organist, unless you knew Rogine, who's even better, of course. I want to make Rogine feel good for not being here. I mean, she's they're both fabulous, all right? Let's say they're equally fabulous in their own way. And Carol was extra fabulous for stepping in on short notice. There. How's that? Is that some? That's well, see, there's a reason you write sermons out. And thank you all for coming on Easter Sunday. We're glad to see you Easter Sunday and every Sunday. And thanks to all the members of this church who make this wonderful community possible. Those who stripped the altar a couple of days ago and put it all back together so it looks fabulous. This is a great and wonderful Sunday. This is, as I mentioned last week, perhaps the most momentous time of year in all American history. Presidents Abraham Lincoln and Franklin Roosevelt died at this time of year, and the American Civil War effectively ended. World War II in Europe likewise effectively ended about this time of year. And then just 90 years before the end of our own Civil War, the American experiment in self-government began in 1776 with Paul Revere's ride and the battles of Lexington and Concord, now celebrated as Patriots Day and the Boston Marathon, etc. On top of that, Thomas Jefferson was born in 1743. Martin Luther King was assassinated in 1968. So this time of year, everything happened. But most importantly, it is Easter Sunday. An event inside of history and outside of history. And Easter Sunday corresponds this year, as it did at the time of the first Easter, with Passover. An Easter Sunday sermon is easily the most difficult sermon of the year to write. Christmas is much easier. We have a baby in a stable surrounded by friendly animals, his loving parents, the shepherds, the stars in the sky, and angels in the heavens, and the whole family of the universe is gathered around. It's warm and cozy, and I love Christmas, and I dread Easter. Talking about a birth is one thing. They happen all the time, and all of us have participated in at least one. We may not remember, but we can't deny that we were there. And talking about the resurrection, and there has only been one, is really difficult. No one has ever seen one. The biblical writers do not seem to know how to talk about it, for they contradict one another, and their accounts are rather maddeningly confusing. Whoever came to that tomb the morning after was probably in shock to start with and went into further shock at whatever they saw. It's amazing that they could report much of anything afterward. So there's nothing else to do than to look at the Holy Scriptures and hope for the best. So, just before what we heard about in today's Gospel, Simon Peter and John have both witnessed the empty tomb. What they thought, we do not know. All the Gospels tell us is that they went home. Sometimes the Bible is like that. You read one of these sentences of the Holy Scripture written by God, yes, and you go, and that's it. They saw an empty tomb, and they went home. And did what? Went to bed? Maybe. Maybe that's the best they could manage after seeing something like that. They saw it. And went to bed and took a tranquilizer if they had one. If they saw the angels that Mary saw, the gospel writers somehow just neglect to mention it. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. So Mary sees them. They even speak to her. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Then we hear nothing more about them, for Mary Magdalene suddenly encounters the risen Lord in the form, she thinks, of the gardener, the caretaker, somebody. And finally, she recognizes him, and he instructs her to tell the others, and so she does. Then Jesus appears to the gospel, to the disciples as well, all of them except Thomas, and that is all the Gospel of John tells us of the day after the resurrection, rather tantalizingly little, but more than the other Gospels have to offer. Now, what I think is important in reading this Gospel and the others is just to conclude that something happened, something terribly important, something that proved that the ministry of Jesus of Nazareth had not ended, but continued, that his earthly physical life had ended, but that he was in some way still with us and remains today. How it happened, how many angels were there, who got there first, exactly what they saw, is certainly fascinating and interesting, but ultimately not that important. The experience of the risen Lord, the feeling that Jesus was still alive, was obviously widespread. It spread like wildfire. Indeed, it was unstoppable back then, and it continues some 2,000 years later. The work of the Spirit goes on. Some people feel the presence of Jesus vividly. Others, not so much. I have spoken about this before. Some people have vivid, powerful religious feelings. Others do not. There is no reason to feel bad if you do not have a vivid religious imagination. For our contemplation and celebration of the resurrection and undying presence of Jesus today, whether you have a vivid imagination or not, let me give two very different accounts of religious experience. Contemporary religious experience. So the specific experience of the presence of Christ in one case, and the experience of dying and being reborn in another case. By two contemporary writers, and in honor of today's gospel that focuses, in addition to the risen Lord, on Mary Magdalene, both of these writers are women. The first is Anne Lamott. Anyone ever heard of Anne Lamott? Mm-hmm. She lives out in California. She celebrates her birthday this time of year. She was born and lives in Northern California. And she was both terribly serious and extremely funny. By the time she was in her mid-20s, she was a successful writer, but she was drinking a lot. This is sometimes called the writer's disease. Okay, writers like to think of themselves as swaggeringly intelligent and just devilishly witty, and a couple of drinks often helps that. But she got to know when to quit, and she didn't. It got so bad that every morning she would have to call her friends to find out what had happened the night before because she'd forgotten. This is not a good sign. Then one day, when she was really hungover, she heard some old spirituals coming out of a little Presbyterian church in Marin City, California. So she went inside to listen to the music. She went back the next week and the next, but she never stayed for the sermon. Bad. But gradually, she began to feel the presence of Jesus around her. And she's written about this. I'm not making this up. And here's what she wrote about it. It was like a little stray cat. You know, I would kind of nudge him with my feet. Him, Jesus. I would nudge him with my feet and say, no, no. Because you can't let him in. Because once you let him in and give him milk, you have a little cat. And I didn't want it. I lived on a tiny little houseboat at the time, and I didn't have any time in my life for a cat. Or for Jesus either. But finally one day I said, oh, whatever, you can come in. So she joined the church, remains a member, quit drinking, and continues to write wonderfully serious and funny stuff about God, about addiction, about life, whatever. I recommend her. For another experience, another way to experience the risen Lord, another way to experience the resurrection, I turn to the poet Mary Oliver, who's often described as a nature poet, but there's more to her poetry than that. There's a profound Christian element in it, I think. Now, whether she is a Christian, explicit or implicit or not, we do not know, because she almost never gives interviews. She prefers to let her poetry speak for itself. So here, let's let this poem speak to you. It's called Sleeping in the Forest. I thought the earth remembered me. She took me back so tenderly, arranging her dark skirts, her pockets full of lichens and seeds. I slept as never before, a stone on the riverbed. Nothing between me and the white fire of the stars but my thoughts. And they floated light as moths among the branches of the perfect trees. All night I heard the small kingdoms breathing around me, the insects and the birds who do their work in the darkness. All night I rose and fell, as if in water, grappling with a luminous doom. By morning, I had vanished at least a dozen times into something better. This is a human being understanding that she herself is not the most important thing in the universe. She is in grasp of a far greater force than she, and that is okay. St. John tells us at the beginning of his gospel that Christ was in the beginning with the Father, and through him all things were made. Death and resurrection, dying and rising, surrendering and growing, are in the structure of the universe. They have been there from the beginning of time. Therefore, we find God and Christ and redemption in all aspects of life. Some of us experience the resurrection every time we go to sleep and wake up, every time we let something go, quit worrying about it, and feel grateful for the gift of life. We surrender to God and somehow end up being bigger. Whether God works his way into our lives softly and subtly like a cat, whether we find God in nature or in helping others or in prayer and meditation and just coming to stillness or parenting, we are all blessed by the love that moves the sun and the stars and breathes in us the breath of life. Every day, our life and breath and work and sacrifice allow us to vanish dozens of times into something better. Amen. It's a day for Easter egg hunts. It's appropriate to hunt for the microphone as well. Now is the time in our service to share the joys of this Easter morning.
I'll start us off, Pastor Richard. I just want to tell you, that was a really wonderful sermon. It was just beautiful, really nice. And the other joy is... is that if it wasn't for, I know you already mentioned Carol, but I just want to say that Easter just wouldn't be the same without music. And Carol's fingers, if we probably looked at them, might be calloused, and there are also probably worn marks on the ivories. I thank you for all your work, Carol, and making it Easter with music as well. Thank you.
What a beautiful day it is. It started off this morning at the sunrise service at Colleyville. Michael led a wonderful, it was a very beautiful service this morning. And John and crew did a wonderful breakfast downstairs. It was really delicious. And it was a lovely, lovely service this morning. And Isabella turned 2 today, as Michael mentioned. We're very excited.
And Richard? Look at the altar. Everybody have a chance to look at that altar. Sue did a beautiful job. Yes. We are so blessed.
I just want to say what a wonderful Monday, Thursday service that we had here at the church. It was very prayerful. And I think that everybody that had come would agree with me that it was probably one of the best Monday Thursdays, and thank you very much, Richard, for that. And also yesterday, one of my great-grandbabies turned 1 and went over to their house. Of course, they have like a $200, you know, festivities going on for this 1-year-old. And I had a wonderful time to see all the kids and everything. There's probably about 35, 40 people in and out of there. And Bob, not so much.
There is joy in this house today, and my all-time joy is that I have Jesus as my Savior, that He died for me, and this is the reason that we are here today.
Yes, I have a nice joy here. I told Mary. I'm going to have the opportunity to make her jealous because I have her do my grandbabies here. Charlotte and Izzy and their parents.
I personally am grateful for, sunshine this morning to start with. And the bronchitis that I've had seems to be finally exiting. I wish it would hurry up, but it seems to be on its way out the door. So every time you've noticed after you've been sick, you get a little burst sometimes. It's a good thing. Okay, will the deacons please come forward, give generously of your resources for God's work in this church. Thank you.
was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, I'm
gifts of our offering. May you use these gifts with your spirit and love for those in this community that need it the most, for this community at large, for this state, for those who need to hear the gospel the most. We thank you for your presence and your glorious resurrection. We give you thanks every day. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
I would ask you to keep Regina in prayer. She is not with us this week because a very dear cousin died in Washington State. So she flew out there on Wednesday, and we'll be back here for next Sunday. But if you would just pray for peace and safe travel for her.
I would ask you to pray for me and my family. My youngest brother passed away this week. And I especially pray that God's hand will be over it all. I could use a couple of prayers this week as I deal with some medical issues.
And prayers for the Donovan family, who were brought up in Gloucester. One of the boys died this week. His name is, I believe, Tom. And he was quite young.
I'm going to add a joy at the end here. You can always share a joy at any time you wish. Carol Green is here. She's in the back. And she is a member of the United Church of South Royalton, of which was the pastor a rather long time ago. And I baptized these two relatives of hers way a long time ago when they were very, very small. And they're here with us today. So give them a warm welcome. I'm so glad to see them. Please join me for a moment of silent prayer, and then I'll pray on behalf of us all. Trust with justice and mercy. pray especially for those people mentioned today, for those concerns. We pray that you comfort the hearts and aid the healing hands of those who work with those in need, whether they be sick and gravely ill, or their hunger knows no end. For those dealing with mental illness and just the stresses and strains of life, may your soothing and healing and loving presence be with us. And with our sister churches in Gray and throughout the state, for those who serve you, however they proclaim the gospel, may they proclaim and live out your gospel with love and justice and mercy. And give us your mercy and love as we serve you, as we do the best we can, as we make our mistakes. May your love and forgiveness and triumphant power be with us. May our hearts be full of gratitude and rejoicing for the gift of life, especially on this beautiful Easter Sunday. Thank you for the gift of family and friends and the gift of our blessings beyond number. Almighty God, who for our redemption, you gave your only begotten Son to death on the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemies. Grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him, our Lord, and with you in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And be with us as we pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, render to no one evil for evil, but overcome evil with good, and love God and love your neighbors with all of your hearts, with all of your minds, and with all of your strength. Amen. Amen.